All right, here we are at a place that I think everybody needs to come when they come to Petersburg. A lot of people just go through the main parts of the park, which is great, and then they check out some of the places along the way, Fort Wadsworth, or maybe they walk the breakthrough battlefield that the Trust helped to preserve, maybe go to Pamplin Park, but a lot of people skip this place, Confederate Fort Gregg, known as the Confederate Alamo. This is April 2nd, 1865, when the world is falling apart for the Confederates, and there is going to be a desperate fight here. And for that, let's once again bring on, maybe for the last time on this series, our good friend A. Wilson Greene.
Thanks, Garry. We're standing here at Confederate Fort Gregg. And this is really a very dramatic story here. This fort was designed in October of 1864, suggested by Wade Hampton as a fallback position, very prescient on the part of Hampton, as a fallback position in case the main Confederate line, which is located about 3/4 of a mile off here to the south and the west, would ever be breached. Well, of course, that's exactly what happens on April 2nd, 1865. Confederate defenders here numbered less than 300 men. There was a twin fort 600 yards off here to the north and a little bit to the west called Fort Whitworth. There were a couple of hundred men in that fort as well. This was the last stand for the Confederate Army. Their mission was to buy time for Longstreet's men to come from north of the James River to man the innermost Confederate defenses, which are in front of me here at a distance of about a half a mile. And in order to try to do that, they would have to defeat two divisions of the Union 24th Corps. About 1 o'clock in the afternoon, those two divisions, about a brigade at a time, attack this position. Now, they outnumber the Confederates here 10-1. The Federals get into these deep moats. The moat was 6 feet deep and 14 feet wide. The Federals get into that moat. They try to scramble up the banks by putting their bayonets into the side of the earthworks. The Confederates club them down, shoot them down. More Federals come onto the scene. And finally, about an hour later, after 714 Union casualties, the Federals are able to scramble up on top of the parapet, get around here to the back of the fort, which is protected by a palisade, not earthworks, and have a hand-to-hand fight with the surviving Confederates. Every one of the Confederate defenders of Fort Gregg became a casualty. Every one. And there were 65 other Confederate casualties in Fort Whitworth, but they had done their job. When this fort was captured and Fort Whitworth was captured, two brigades of Longstreet's Corps had taken position in the inner Confederate lines of the Demock Line, and that would buy the sufficient time for General Lee to evacuate the city that night.
That's great. And while I'm going to wrap things up here, come on, Doug, let's take a look at this painting here, because I do think it gives a good example. Not only this fort's in a very good state of preservation, Will pointed out on the way out, you can still see the gun ramps along the fort where the cannons could get up there. But remember, revetments along the fort. Of course, there are cannons, and here it shows men of the 24th Corps sort of scrambling up here in this last desperate fight here at Petersburg. And you can see some of the moat over here as well. Now, what this will result in, as Will said, is that the Confederates are able to evacuate Petersburg, and that sets into motion another incredible chain of events that's beyond the scope of this particular swing, at least in Maine. Remember, Lee is going to move west. That's going to result in a series of actions, namely the Battle of Sailor's Creek. My God, has this army been dissolved, said Robert E. Lee, losing so much of his army there. The Battle of High Bridge, and then, of course, it's going to descend to Appomattox, where there's a fight and then a surrender. Now, while that surrender is happening, or after it, word starts to leak out, and the word of Lee's surrender comes into North Carolina. It comes into the surrender negotiations going on between Sherman and Joseph E. Johnston. See, it's all connected, Sherman and Grant, Lee and Johnston. We're not all that far apart at this point, and the theaters began to merge at that point. And we're, I hope, going to pick up that story at one of those places later. So thanks so much for joining us for all of our Petersburg coverage and for all your support of battlefield education and preservation.